good evening. Good evening to you. Oh man, I tell you, it's a joy to be with you each and every week as we are able to open the Word of God and to share the glorious message of the kingdom of God with you, my brothers and sisters, and those of you who tune in tonight. Again, we're delighted to be with you, and we trust that the word tonight will not only enrich your heart and your life, but you'll get answers from God, or the Spirit of God would speak to you personally that would give you breakthroughs and aid you in the different aspects or even challenges that you are facing. So we are excited tonight. I am Rodolfo Peterkin, yours truly. I am the president and founder of Rodolfo Peterkin Ministries and the Seed Center. And we are in the great city of Melbourne, Florida. And we love to invite all of you, those of you who would like to come, those of you in the immediate area, you'd like to visit with us, then we would love nothing more for you to come by, visit with us, enjoy the Word of God and the fellowship with us, all right? We're located at 420 South Babcock. And again, we encourage you to come by and visit with us. Also want to remind you, been saying this a few weeks now, want to encourage those of you who follow our ministry, you are connected with us in one way or the other, and even those of you that this may be your first time listening to us or visiting, want to encourage you to go to our YouTube channel. Just go to YouTube, put in my name, Rodolfo Peterkin, and a video come up, and just on the very bottom, I want you to just go ahead and subscribe, right? Go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel, and that way, as we have certain things that we want to send out, you know, we may want to send out information to you guys, then we would love to be able to just do that, all right? So, again, I want to encourage you, just go to YouTube and just type in Rodolfo Peterkin. That's R-O-D-O-L-F-O, Peterkin. And my name will come up or video will come up, and just on the very bottom, on the middle of it, you'll see where it says subscribe. And just go ahead and click on that and follow, okay? And just subscribe to our YouTube channel. I want to encourage those of you, while we are teaching the Word of God tonight, if you've got any questions, I want you to feel free, right in the comment section, I want you to feel free to write your question in, all right? I want to entertain those questions. Remember, with me, there's no stupid question. There is none, all right? I know where I come from and some of the challenges I've had and sometimes still have. Maybe in understanding some things, and hey, look, the Holy Spirit helps me to learn it, to get it. And so if I can be of any help to you in helping you to grab a hold of it, to understand what God is saying, then please just write it in the comment section. I will see and I will entertain it. If there's a comment, please feel free to also do that, all right? We want to make sure that we entertain any questions or any comments that you may have. And whatever part of the world you're in that you're listening to this broadcast, whether it is live or a rebroadcast, if you don't mind, just tell us where you're hearing this this broadcast, from what part of the country or what part of the world that you are listening to us. All right, wonderful, Jesus. Well, let's just pray, all right, and let's begin our teaching tonight. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. Thank you for the understanding of your word. Your word says that it brings light and it gives understanding even to the simple. And so we thank you, Lord, that these lips of clay will speak as an oracle of God. And you'll cause me to say the things that I need to say, Lord, that the people that are listening need to hear. Direct my thoughts, Lord God, in Jesus' name, and have full control tonight. Heal the sick that are listening to me, those who are cast down, depressed, tormented, whatever their issue or problems are tonight. I pray that you will touch them in a powerful way, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we have been teaching on dressing to the nines. Dressing to the nines. That's an old idiom, an old way of saying that you are dressed to the T. You are sharp. You're put together well. You know, I mean, you've got everything in order. All right? And what that is just another way that I use in speaking about the armor of God. And a better way is I like to call it God's clothing. All right? Because when you look at the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of peace, when you look at all of that, the loinbelt of truth, when you look at all the different aspects of the armor of God, then you're really talking about God's clothing. You're talking about aspects of God that he makes available to us in order to fight the adversary and to deal sometimes fatal blows to the enemy when he comes at us, or he's attacking us or fighting us in our everyday life or in different aspects or areas of our lives. We have everything we need to be successful. We have everything we need to have an upper hand on the enemy. We have everything we need to have complete victory in everything that comes against us. You say, brother, what if I die believing God? That's ultimate victory. That's the totality of victory. That's where all of us want to be sooner or later. All right? So in God, we don't lose. All right? And while you are on the earth, walking and living on the earth, we understand, Jesus said in John 16:33, in the world you will have trouble. But he said, be of good cheer. Why? Because he has overcome the world. All right? And so everything that you and I need, then, God has made sure that it's available for us. But it's up to you. And it's how you apply yourself to learn it and to understand it so that you may rightfully apply it and have the benefits of it. And many times in the church world, we hear things, we shout about them, but we don't really know how they work. We don't really know how to put it to work, how to apply it. And so sometimes we bunch it all up into one, and we don't experience what God wants us to. And I hope as we're teaching this, then you will see, because we're dealing with all kinds of prayer. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18, from the armor, we're on the last armor, right? The last part of the armor. And Paul says, praying always with all prayer and supplication. Another translation says, praying always with all manner of prayer and all kinds of prayer. And so when you begin to understand this, then you understand that one size doesn't fit all. You understand? One rule cannot be applied to all the different forms of prayer. You need to understand the different forms of prayer. And like the Roman soldier that we are contrasting this with, one of the things the Roman soldier had, and they took it whenever they went to war, when they went fighting, is that they had at least five short, what we call lances. And if you look, again, if you look at any one of these first century wars and stuff like that, you'll see them with these lances that they will use. The small ones or the short ones was simply used if your opponent was 2-3 feet away from you. It was really used in order to jab him, right? Or to stab him with it. That really lends a fatal blow to your enemy. And then when they fall on the ground, then it's just a matter of decapitating them, right? That's what the Roman soldier would do. And then you also had the long ones, the 6-7 feet lances, which are actually spears, right? And you're able to throw those. It is said that The weight of them helps them to soar through the air a lot easier, and sometimes they will change the head of these things, the head of the spear, that just does deadly damage to the adversary. And so, you know, we don't use spears today, right? Because we have become a little bit more advanced. So now we've got AR-15s and M-16s and Glocks, and you know, we've got all these handguns. We've got M-60 tanks. We've got B-52 bombers and stuff like that. But back then they didn't have those things, right? And so they utilized the things that they could create that was deadly to the adversary. And so Paul, looking at this in his day, he contrasts that with prayer. And so basically what Paul is saying to us by the Holy Spirit, excuse me, is that in our toolbox, there's at least six different kinds of prayer that you and I are able to utilize in order to either hit the enemy, stab him when he gets close by, or you can throw it and deal a fatal blow to him the same way. Okay, and so the scriptures, or I should say the book of Ephesians, as Paul is talking about this, then he's using prayer, again, to contrast, right? To contrast these lances. And he's letting us know that these things are at your disposal. And so you and I need to understand how to use them. So last week or Sunday, we talked about the prayer of petition. And we talked about how the prayer of petition, at the very foundation, the prayer of petition hits the very foundation or goes to the core of the human belief where because of the fall, we thought we were God now and we don't need God, so we get God out of the way. At the very core of it, it destroys that thing because we come to God humbly. We come to God understanding not only our own frailty, but we understand our humanness. We are aware of it. We are aware how limited we are. And so we come to God because there's a need, that an essential need that we have in our lives. And this need may be essential to the point where it's necessary for our survival. And so we turn to God and we ask for God's help. All right, and so we come in the form of, we come humble before God, and we're asking God for this, right? And so we talked about this Sunday, and today what I want to talk about is the prayer of faith. Now we have mentioned this before, but I want to look at it just a little bit different, okay? But we want to talk about the prayer of faith, that the kind of prayer that exudes the authority of God. You exude authority. And that's what you see when Jesus walked up to the tree in Mark chapter 11. And Jesus said to the tree, no man eat food from you hereafter and forever. He cursed the tree, right? And the disciples came back afterwards the next day. And they saw that the tree was dried up. And Peter, everybody said Peter is short for Peterkin. That's right. Peter said, Lord, the tree is dried up. And then Jesus turned to him and said, have faith in God, or have the God kind of faith. And so we want to look at that, this kind of prayer of faith, this kind of prayer of authority, where the authority of God exudes from our lives and our mouth as we demand that certain rights and privileges that we have in our life that's rightfully ours by virtue of the death, burial, and resurrection, that those things are released to us, that the enemy is trying to either keep us from or he's trying to impede us from. Okay, so I want us to look at this, all right? I want us to look at this. So I want you to go with me. Go with me to the book of Luke. The book of Luke. And I want us to look at this. All right? I want us to look at this. All right, Luke chapter 1. Again, we're dealing with all kinds of prayer, and tonight we're dealing with the prayer of faith. or authority, the prayer of faith, where you exercise your authority, you release your authority in God. This is a lot different than the prayer of petition. Okay? And let's look at it. Okay? Let's look at it. It says in verse chapter 11 of Luke, verse 1, it says, "And it came to pass that as he was praying," he being Jesus, "was praying in a certain place. When he stopped," when he ceased, "one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples to pray." Now, I believe here that they experienced something. Don't nobody want to follow or do what you do if you don't get any results with what you do. Nobody want to do that. All right? These guys saw some stuff when Jesus prayed. They saw how he prayed. You said, how's that? Because even Peter was like that. Peter ultimately got a hang of it. And so in Acts chapter 3, the Bible said when they were on their way to prayer, all right, Peter saw a man that was begging. And look, Peter, the Bible said he didn't have any money to give him, but he told the man, "Look on us." And when he got that man's attention, he said, "Silver and gold, I don't." He didn't pray. He didn't pray. He exercised authority. And I'm going to show you how. I'm going to show you through the scriptures how this stuff works. Okay, Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but what I do have, I give unto you." And then he said, "In the name," that's not a prayer. He said, "In the name of Jesus, get up." And the Bible said he reached out and grabbed the man by his hands and pulled him up. And the man stood walking and leaping and praising God. How does this work? How does all this thing happen? I want to show you a few points. All right? I want to show you a few pointers. I want you to stay with me, okay? I want to show you a few pointers of how we can flush this out. We have a lot of people in the church world that sometimes believe that God will do it for the pastor or the preacher. But somehow God doesn't do it for me. Or God doesn't hear me like he hears them. Or God will do it for that person that's really anointed. But after all, I'm not anointed like them. I'm a homemaker. You know, nobody knows me very well in church and all of these things that they would say. I don't have a platform. I'm not in front of people. A whole lot of people don't know my name. If I pass, hardly nobody would know but my family who I am. Are you listening to me? They have they have nothing about them that's prominent in their city or even prominent in the church. And so they look at all these things and they say, well, God will do it for that person, but for me, oh no. But you see, you're missing something. You're missing something. The scripture says that God knows everything. And so you have to understand that when it comes to God and the kingdom of God, nobody is at the back of the line. All of us are sons of God. All of us have the same promises and the same inheritance that was given to us by virtue of the death, burial, and resurrection is for every one of us. It doesn't matter if you have a high degree of anointing or not. And you got to understand something about the anointing. The anointing is not the thing that makes you sons of God. The Bible says you and I become sons of God by virtue of faith in Christ. But the anointing comes upon us for us to do a certain thing that God has gifted us to do. So some people have a gift to do some things, and they have a high a degree of anointing to do what God has told them to do. You may not have an anointing like that, but it doesn't make you any less a son of God. Are you following me? It doesn't make you any less. It doesn't mean God knows you less, or God doesn't, you know, certain things are not for you because you're not in front of the people like that. That's not what the Bible teaches. Are you following me? You're a son of God by virtue of faith in Christ. And as a result of that, all the promises of God are yes to you and amen. You see, everything that Jesus died for you to have is the same thing he died for your pastor or the apostle. All of us got the same thing. Are you with me? All right. Okay. Let's go on and look at this. So they said, Lord, teach us how to pray as your disciples taught us. Matthew goes on. Matthew records this the same way. And he said unto them, when you pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is where? In heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And now Jesus, he's going to do something that Matthew doesn't do, okay? Or Matthew doesn't record. Jesus is going to expound on this. He's going to expound on this kind of a prayer, okay? Now watch him now. And he says to them, which of you shall have a friend? Now I want you to underline the word friend, okay? He didn't say have a neighbor. He didn't say have an acquaintance or a stranger. He said, which of you shall have a friend? Okay, so you gotta mark that, okay? And shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine is come in his journey. He is come and I have nothing set before him. So now watch this now. Jesus said, he's teaching about prayer. He said a friend of a friend comes and says, he comes to the man at midnight. So you have to look at it. At midnight, they're in the bed. They have their PJs on. Mama is in the bed. Kids are in the bed. This is really not a time to come and disturb this family. They are more than likely asleep or going to sleep. Are you following me? And so Jesus says he comes at midnight. He comes at a very inopportune time. All right? He comes at a time where what he wants and what he's asking can be a bit bothersome. Okay? As my grandmas and them taught us and my mom growing up, you gotta know when to excuse yourself from a person's home. Right about 9, 10 o'clock. That's pretty late. And you gotta know when to leave. Those are etiquette that you're taught. You follow me? And so this guy comes at a very inconvenient time. Okay, and that's the word, inconvenient time, 12 midnight. And he says to his friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. And he said, because a friend is coming his journey, and he's come to me, and I have nothing set before him. So what do I care about that, right? Now let me say right up front that the friend is not a type of God. Okay? That's not God. Jesus is trying to teach us something here. Verse 7. And he said, and he from within shall answer. That's the friend. He's going to answer and said, don't bother me. You had anybody tell you that? Look, I'm going to bed. Talk to me in the morning. You know? You know a real friend. Because a real friend, you call them anytime. And boy, they'll get up. What's going on? What do you need? How can I help you? This guy said, don't trouble me. Or he said, don't trouble me not. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. Look at him. I cannot rise and give it to you. I got it. but I can't get up, man. You are inconveniencing me now. I don't want to get up now. All right, look at this again. Okay, look at this. Look, this is Jesus talking. Then Jesus said, I say unto you. So in other words, then, the little story that he just gave us is to teach these disciples about the very thing that they asked them about. Okay? And we're dealing with the prayer of faith, or the prayer where you exercise authority to get what you need. You jab the devil. You demand certain things, all right? Now watch this. Jesus said, I say unto you, though he will not rise, and give him because of his friendship. Okay? Yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. Now, let's look for a couple of things. That word importunity, it is the word that means persistence. And it is persistence to the point of annoyance. Did you hear that? It is persistence to the point of annoyance. It is someone that comes or wants something, and they come without any bashfulness. They're not bashful. They just ask for what they want. They know what they want, and they just ask for it. And in asking without bashfulness, there is a great degree of confidence that they exude. It's a great degree of confidence, of shamefacedness. They don't have any shame. They just ask for what they want. This is what Jesus is saying here. And so he says, though they won't get up simply because they're your friends, he said, yet because of their importunity, because of their shamefacedness, because of their unbashfulness, because of their persistence to the point of annoyance, then he says the person will get up and give it to them. Look at verse 9. It says, and I say unto you, ask. Right? Now that word ask is the Greek word A-I-T-E-O, ateo. You can look it up in your Strong's Concordance. It is ateo. And this word, ask, means to demand. It means to crave, to have a strong desire. It means to demand. So this kind of a prayer is not the kind of a prayer that we talked about, the prayer of petition, where you come and you're humble, all right? And you recognize not only your limitations, but you also recognize within yourself, you recognize that you are, you recognize your own humanity, and you are incapable of doing or performing what you need, and you come to God that way. This takes a different turn here. This word means to demand. It literally means to demand. It implies a person that is, it does not imply a person that is humbly asking. Rather, it speaks about an individual that knows who they are and the authority that they have. And so therefore they come to God, or they deal with the situation in the utmost confidence. It's almost like they have no bashfulness about them. They bust in, they demand certain things. You say, wow, you say, can a person really demand this? this don't sound right. Well, it is right, because it's in your Bible. Read it. It's in your Bible. He said, ask and it shall be given. That's what Jesus said. The word is demand. He said, seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be what? Open unto you. And then he said, for everyone that asks and keep on asking receives. And he that seeks and keep on seeking finds. And to him that knocks and keep on knocking, it shall be open. And then he goes down and he said, if a son shall ask bread of any of you that's a father, will he give him a stone? If he asks for an egg, will he give if he asks for a fish, will he give him a snake or a serpent? If he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then being evil, know how to give good gifts unto them, unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the what? The Holy Spirit to them that ask. Now, let's work on this a little bit, all right? Because this was one of the problems. If you flip over to Luke 15, that's correct. That's correct. You're just a little ahead of myself, Lorraine, but that is correct. The type of demand that you speak of still has to align with God's word. You see, I want to build it because I want you to understand. I want you, those of you who are listening, I want you to see. But that is definitely correct. Now, in Luke 15, here's the scenario, right? The two sons. Now, watch me now. Watch me now. The father says to the older son that was under his authority, never got from under his authority, to some degree, remain faithful and loyal to the father, did not oppose the father like the youngest son. He was totally upset when his son came back and what the father did. And he refused to go into the party, you see. And he pretty much told his father, he said, all my years have I served you faithfully, and not one time have I done this to you. And this your son, notice, he didn't say my brother, he said, this your son. Look how he's treated you. Look at the shame. Look at the stuff that he's brought upon our name. Look at all that he's done. He's went on and messed with harlots and all of that. Look, Lord, at the stuff that he has done to the name of the family. And the first thing you do when he comes back home is you throw a party. How crazy is that? And look what the father said to him. He said, son, verse 31, you are ever with me, and all that I have is what? Is yours. It was right for me to do this. Because you see, the son complained that you never once gave me anything, a goat, anything to have a party with my friends. And now you're throwing on a party. But you see, the father put the stuff back in his life. The father said, you're always with me. Everything that I have is yours. You have access to everything I got. And if you wanted to, you could have done this. The problem is that you are my son. You are in relationship with me. You have a right to all of this stuff. And for whatever reason, you never stepped in with confidence. You never went out there and took what's yours. What I have that's rightfully yours because I'm your father, you never stepped in here and grabbed onto it with authority and declared what's rightfully yours and did what you need to do with it. You were here waiting for me to hand it to you. This is very important for you to understand. This was one of the reasons why his father had to say this to the older son. Well, it's the same thing here. And follow me here. It is the same thing here. The person that that has this kind of prayer of authority, this prayer of faith, you know, this is the person the Bible says that they demand. But you have to understand who they're demanding. It's not that they're demanding God. There's no reason to demand God, because God is the one that killed his son so that you can have all of this. So there's no reason to demand this from God. You are demanding your rights and privilege to the forces of darkness, situations and circumstances that is confronting you, that are trying to impede and or restrict you from having the things that God designed for you to have. Lorraine says, when Hezekiah asked not to die, and God extended his life 15 years, what kind of a prayer is that? That more than likely, that was a prayer of petition. And you go back and you see, Hezekiah couldn't change that on his own. And as far as Hezekiah believed, this was essential. This was necessary for him. He needed that, right? He was petitioning God. He was petitioning God for it. Okay? This is a little different, because Jesus said, and I say unto you, ask. The word ask here is the word to demand. So how do I demand some things? How do I demand these things? What is God talking about? Over there in the book of Isaiah, where it says, according to the works of my hands, command ye me. So I understand that I don't have to command God, because it is God that has brought me into this, right? He says in Hebrews chapter 4, come boldly. Notice what he said. Come boldly unto the throne of grace, that you might obtain mercy and find grace to help you where? In the time of need. So there is a place in prayer, right? And there is another way that you and I can deal in prayer, and this kind of a shamefacedness or unbashfulness, this kind of a persistence, this kind of a I don't want to say no care attitude, but this kind of an attitude where this thing belongs to me and I want it and I will have it. How do I get all of that? Well, I think the scriptures is very clear. It's very clear on how you and I function in this. And I want to show you real quickly. Look at John 15. Come on, go with me. John 15. Flip over one more book and look at John 15. Because the question would be, how do I do this? And like one of the comments made is that this kind of a prayer, of course, must align with the Word of God. Definitely. Look at John 15. John 15. John 15, and look at verse 7. John 15 and verse 7. Okay, look at John, verse 7. Look at it. It says, if you abide where? If you abide in me. That word abide means to make your home in. Okay? And this is the thing that the Lord has really been, and I know he's talking to me, but really been impressing on my spirit. Because you and I need to be aware that although you live in this physical world and you're in a physical body, according to Ephesians 1 and 3, you have been raised up and made to sit where? In heavenly places in Christ Jesus. According to Colossians 1 and 13, you are living in the kingdom of God. So all that heaven has is at your disposal, according to God's word. And so you and I need to be self-aware of these things. We need to be aware of what we have, what is at our disposal, and we become skillful of walking in it, of utilizing it. Jesus said, if you abide, that means to make your home in. It means that you dwell in, you reside there. It is your home. It says, Lauren said, how does one take their issues and learn how to align it with God's word? Here is how you do this. That's a good question. Here is how you do this. The Bible says, if you abide, that means you make your home in. It means that you dwell in, you remain in. You don't just visit. You don't go there once a year. Are you following me? This is not something that you do ever so often when you feel there is a need. No, that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you abide, you make your home in, you dwell in, you remain in, you stay in union, in fellowship with me. Watch what he says now. And my word does the same thing. My word dwell in, make its home in you, reside in you. Now watch what he says. You will ask what you will, and it's going to be done to you. You see, because if I don't know what's mine, see the oldest son in Luke 15? Undoubtedly, he didn't know what was his. The father told him, you could have had the courage to go and take, spend whatever you wanted because it's yours. And you're sitting there waiting on me to give you something. And so all this time that you have been waiting, you have done without, because you have been waiting when all you had to do as a son of mine is go and take what's yours. Does that make sense? And so what happens to many of us is that we don't abide in. We don't remain in. We don't make our home in. Are you listening to me? And we don't let the word of God, Colossians 3 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. That's what he's talking about. Now, why would Jesus tell you that? Because if I dwell in him like that, consciously in him like that, and his word dwell in me consciously like that, then anything that I ask, anything that I demand, because remember, I'm in union with him. The Spirit of God is flowing in me. The Holy Spirit of God is communicating with me. And so when the enemy is combating me or coming against me, if he's close enough to me, there is a prayer that I can pull out where I can stab him with it. If I'm engaged in intercessory prayer and I have to hit him from afar, I can hit him with it with prayer. No different. But I have to know what is mine. I have to understand what's rightfully mine. I don't care who didn't get it. I don't care who you know that tried and didn't get it. That doesn't make no never mind. That doesn't deduct from the word of God. If I tried and I didn't get it, that doesn't change what God's word says. You have to go by the written word. If you abide in me and my word, not what your friend experienced, not what Susie or Johnny experienced, but my word abide in you, then you can ask what you will. Jesus says that the confidence of asking, okay, displaying such confidence to ask, to demand, that's the same word. Displaying this kind of a confidence to demand comes from the fact, displaying this kind of a, it comes from the fact that you know if you're in it and it's in you, then you know what is rightfully yours. You know what the word of God says. You know what Christ says in his word about the matter. You know what the will of God is in written form. You know what it is. And if it's not in written form and you're asking God about something, the Holy Spirit will communicate to you through His Spirit. He will communicate to you God's will for you in this matter. And you'll be amazed of how the Word of God will come alive to you in so many ways in order to give you direction on what to do. Are you with me? I said, are you with me? See, that kind of a prayer where we talk about, oh Lord, if you're not too busy, come by here. That's not in the Bible. It sounds good, but that's not biblical. Because the Bible tells you God is already everywhere. I'm not throwing any pots at anyone. I'm not punching at anyone. But we need to understand how these things function, man. You know, prayer doesn't work in a vacuum. Prayer doesn't function in a vacuum. It's not separate from God and from everything else. That's not how prayer functions. It's not an exercise that we do that is simply just an exercise. There's no benefits to it. That's the furthest thing from the truth, folks. It's not how long you pray. It's whether you pray in line with the Word of God, whether you pray in line with the will of God, and whether you know something, whether you have confidence with it. And so Jesus said, if you abide in me, if you live and settle down in, if you make your residence in me, and my word lives in you, settle down in you, and make his, what? His residence in you. Then you can ask what you will, because what you ask will be in line with what his will is. Are you with me? Whatever you ask, if you have God's word, you'll be, you say, oh my God, if that's the case, man, then I won't be able to ask for a whole lot of stuff. Where do you get that from? Where do you get that from? What is this? Psalm 16, where the Bible says that God says, in my presence, there what? There is fullness of joy, and at my right hand, there what? There are pleasures forevermore. We have concepts of God that's not biblical. Because the Word of God covers everything that you will ever need. 2 Peter 1 says that God has given you all things. All things that pertains to what? To life and to godliness. So if we're filled with the Word of God, man, the Word of God will help us. The Word of God will illumine us. It will enlighten us. Are you listening to me? You can pray and God answers your prayer. You can know, you can have confidence to the point where your confidence is God is unbashful. It's unabated. You talk with God to God with such confidence, such knowing. You don't take no as an answer. The only way you can have such confidence is because you know his word. And you believe his word. Don't you know that is a lance that will deal the devil a very fatal blow? Are you with me? I said, are you with me? I can't hear you. Are you with me? Glory. Let me give you another scripture. I want you to go to 1 John. Go to 1 John. This word means to ask, to demand. You remember in Acts 3, when Peter met that guy at the gate, beautiful, he didn't pray for him. He demanded certain things. He didn't demand it from God. In other words, Peter, watch me now, Peter stood as a man with confidence, knowing that he was an ambassador of God, that he represented Christ, and what the devil did to the man, Peter demanded that that stuff leave him. Are you listening to me? Releasing, in other words, he acted, watch me now, he acted in God's stead. What did Isaiah 6 says? Isaiah 6 says, who will go for me? And who can I send? Let me tell you exactly where it is, okay? Because, you know, I can get a little happy here, and I can go 50 miles an hour, and I have to remember, no, I can't go 50 miles an hour. This is Bible study. Look at this. Isaiah 6. Verse 8. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And the prophet said, here am I. Send me. Do we even understand? I'm not talking about we read it, we heard it. I'm talking about it's in us. It is part of our belief system. It's ingrained in us. It's part of our psyche. Do we even understand that we are God's representative? We literally represent him on the earth. Is that right? Look at 1 John. 1 John 5. 1 John 5. This is how it works, folks. This is how it works. 1 John 5. Look at this. Verse 14. Well, let me go to 13. He said, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. He didn't say believe. He said that you might know, that you may stand on firm footing. You know that you have eternal life, and that you might believe on the name of the Son of God. Watch this now. And then he says, and this is the confidence. There's the word again. This is the that is the boldness. Come boldly unto the throne of grace. This is the confidence that we have. How? That we have where? Come on, help me. That we have in him. Not in someone else's circumstance. Not in your brother or your sister experience. No. Nothing wrong with their experience, folks. But this is the confidence that you have in him. Because if their experience don't line up to the word of God, that don't mean you have to have their experience. Listen to it. You ought to write this down and take it to the bank. You can have from God whatever you're willing to believe for. And your experience is not limited to someone else's belief. It is limited to yours and yours only. And this is why Satan works overtime, because he's got to get you and I to not to believe this. So Jesus says, excuse me, Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you can ask whatever you will. So what is the secret? Remember, Jesus said, a friend came to a friend. He didn't say a neighbor. This is Luke 11. He didn't say a neighbor. He said a friend came to his friend at midnight. I thought that was very, very important. Because one of the things the Holy Spirit quickened to my heart here is that there was some sort of relation here. He wasn't just an extended acquaintance. He wasn't someone that they knew. This was a friend. And with God, you and I have you and I have a relationship with him. We are his children. We are his sons. He comes in an opportune time. He comes at midnight, a time where the other person is in bed. But what Jesus wants you to see is that he did not allow midnight to stop him from asking. And when the friend said, look, it's late. I don't want to get up. I can't get up now. He did not relent. And I believe one of the reasons he didn't relent is because he just wasn't asking Tom, Dick, or Harry. He was asking his friend. And in asking his friend, he demonstrated boldness. See, he demonstrated an attitude that he knew his friend would get up and get it for him. Do you know that God will give it to you? Do you know that God will get up and make sure you have it? Do you know that God would move heaven, hell, and earth in order to come to your beckon? Do you know that? You said, no, I don't know that. Well, you don't know that because you're not in the Word to know that. If you're in the Word and the Word gets in you and gets all over on the inside of you, you will develop a confidence where you know it to be true. This is what Jesus is trying to get us to understand. He's trying to get us to learn that, to know this. Are you listening to me? I said, are you listening to me? I said, are you out there? This is what he's saying. He said, though the friend didn't get up simply because it's his friend, but the friend got up because the friend was unbashful. The friend showed no shame. He didn't bend his head. He talked to his friend as though, even though it wasn't the right time, you've got to get up. Good God Almighty. And nothing, this doesn't make sense. Or it would make sense if this was just a neighbor. But it makes perfect sense because Jesus said, this is a friend. There's some relationship there. Jesus said he wouldn't get up just because he knew the person or he was a friend, but he'd get up because his friend was so persistent unto the point where it was annoyed. He was annoyed. Are you listening to me? And then he said to you and I, he said, and I say unto you, ask. That means he said, I say unto you, demand. So listen to what 1 John says. We're about to close. 1 John 5 says, this is the confidence. This is the boldness. This is the courage that you have when you're in prayer. You see, this is the reason why you can be persistent. How can I be persistent? Because I know what God's promised me. I know according to my covenant with God and what the Holy Writ says, I know what's rightfully mine in God. And though it tarry, I said, though it tarry, he says, wait for it. It'll surely come to pass. Are you feeling me? Are you following what I'm saying? Do you feel what I'm saying? This is how you can get there, folks. This is how you can know this. I didn't say it. God said it. This is the confidence that you have in him. That if you ask anything, according to what? According to his will. How do I know his will? Well, I am in the word. And if I let his word settle down in me, if I let his word abide in me, if I let his word make his home in me, and I make my home in his word, in him, I settle down in him, I remain connected in union, in fellowship with him, then the Bible says that the confidence that you will have, the persistence that you will have, almost to the point of annoyance. Why is it to the point of annoyance? Because it never once crossed your mind that God don't want to give it to you. It doesn't cross your mind that I can't have it. it doesn't cross your mind that maybe God is saying no, or God is saying that I can't have it because of this. It don't even cross your mind. You don't even let the enemy get an advantage over you with that. Why? Because you know the word. You know what his word says. Therefore, you know what his will is. So you don't have to go tiptoeing to the tulips. You don't have to talk to God as though, God, you're a beggar, you're a pauper. Are you listening to me? You don't have to do this. You go to God as a son. You go in there boldly as a son, and you bring before him what he said in his word, and you stare the devil down in his face. You may be laid on your sick bed. Are you hearing me? They might have told you that you're going to die. Cancer may have eaten up your body. It does not matter. You know what I believe? I believe you don't stop fighting until you stand in the presence of God. Are you listening to me? You don't stop standing on his word until you do. You remember what Paul said? Paul said, the time of my departure has come. He said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. They're taking me to sever my head from my body. And while I'm walking down there, I'm not walking as one defeated. He said, the time of my departure has come. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. And what did he say? Come on. What did he say? My faith is slipping. He didn't say that. His circumstances didn't let him say that. Why? Because he knew it was time for him to leave here. He said, I have kept what? I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. Therefore, there's laid up a crown of righteousness for me. And not only for me, but for all those who love his appearing. What am I saying to you? It's the same thing. He said, this is the confidence that we have in him. That if we ask anything according to his will, he do what? He hears me. He's not talking about, you know, just with your ear. I know God hears you, but it's more than just hearing you. He not only hears you, he tells you what that means. He said, it says, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, why? Because we're asking according to his will. If we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask or demand, look it up in the Greek. Whatsoever we ask, listen to me, we hope. No, he didn't say we hope. He said, we maybe think. He didn't say that. He said, we think. It didn't say that. Maybe one day. It didn't say that. It says, we know. That's affirmative. That word is filled with confidence. It's filled with the determination. It's filled with a know that you know it. Are you listening to me? He said, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. We ain't hoping anything. We ain't a hoping and a praying anything. There is absolute confidence. Not that I'm going to get it. Not that one day is going to come. Not that maybe. We know it. When do I know it? Right now. How do I know it right now? Because I made my bed in his word. I made my abode in his word. I filled my heart with his word. I live in it and it lives in me. We are one together. And therefore what I ask, I know it is his will. And even though it tarry, the devil can't shake me. Are you listening to me? Time can't shake it from me. Are you hearing me? I can reach out with my lance and stab the devil with it. Because what he wants me is to fall into what? Into depression and oppression. He wants me to fall back into doubt and unbelief. He wants me to, maybe God don't like me like God loves some other. But I don't take the bait. I'm not going there. Why? Because I've made my home in him and he has made his home in me. Are you following me? Are you hearing me? This is the same thing Jesus did in John 11 when he came to Lazarus, right? And he said, your friend is dead. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He praises. Jesus got down. He said, Father, I'm not praying because you didn't hear me. Because I'm paraphrasing. We talked about this a while back. But I'm praying so that these folks around here will know that you sent me. And that what I'm doing at your beckoning call. And he turned around. And what did he say? He said, Lazarus, get up from there. You see, what happens with Jesus is Jesus did most of his praying while he fellowshiped with God. You see, he's connected to God. You understand? He had constant union and fellowship with God. And so when it came now to when he's walking and deal with situations, Jesus did many times. He didn't have to pray because him and his daddy already talked about these things. Can I give you one more scripture? 1 John 3 and verse 22. 1 John 3 and verse 22. Are you there? Are you there? Listen to this. Listen to this scripture. You and I are supposed to be good at prayer. We're supposed to be efficient at it. Are you hearing me? You and I ain't supposed to be tiptoeing through the tulip. And Jesus ain't on earth. You and I are on the earth. And he's on the earth in us. And we're supposed to carry out the Father's pleasure. We're supposed to carry out the Father's will. Look at this. 1 John 3 and verse 22. It says, and whatsoever, glory. And whatsoever we ask. Look up that word. Same word. Ateo. Whatsoever we demand. Watch what it says. We receive of him. Why? Because we keep his word, his commandments. And we do those things that are pleasing in his sight. How am I going to do the things that are pleasing in his sight? Come on. How do I do this? Because remember, prayer is not an exercise. Okay? Prayer is not an exercise that is that functions separate and apart from God. He said, whatsoever I ask, I receive. Not because of who I am. Not because of my status in life or who I rub shoulders with. God couldn't care less about all that. Those things have no influence on God one way or the other. The reason why we receive is because we keep his word. We live in it. We make our home in it. All right? And it makes his home in us. Because we keep, in other words, we do what his word says. Watch this. And we do the things that are pleasing. How do I do that? By simply being in fellowship with him, understanding what his word says, and just living each day, moment by moment. And when you're faced with decisions, your decisions are based upon what? The word of God. And you can't make decisions based on the word of God if you're not in the word of God or you don't know what the word of God says. Are you following me? 1 John, let me see here. 1 John, thank you, Lord. 1 John 1 puts it this way. It says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, how do I walk in the light? I walk in the knowledge of his word. I walk in what his word has revealed to me. If I walk in the light, I'm not in ignorance. I'm not in darkness. I'm walking in the light as he is in the light. Look what he said. We have fellowship with him. I'm sorry. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, does what? It cleanses us from all sin. See what verse 6 says? If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie. And we are not in the truth. We're not doing the truth. How do I dispel this darkness? How do I dispel the ignorance? We got to get in the word. And we got to let the word. Folks, listen to me. I'm about to quote, but listen to me. Listen to me. And the more I'm in this thing, the at least for me, the Holy Spirit impresses consistently. Because I want to know this. I want to excel further than I am in him. You see? And listen to me. You can fill yourself with the word to such a point that the things of God are no longer something you just believe. It begins to be something that you are aware of and that you know, that you have confidence in. Because you're living it and you're experiencing it. If we abide in his word, that word means that we make our home there. See, we remain in him. We dwell in him. That's what changes your mind. That's what changes the way you think. It's no different than if you spend a whole lot of time looking at TV or looking at a certain program, or you spend a lot of time inundating yourself with a certain things. What happened? It's no longer foreign to you. It'll come to a point where it's almost second nature, and you can not only recall it, but you know what to do. Come on, let's not make the things of God so difficult. They're not as difficult sometimes as we make them. Ephesians 3 and verse 20, it says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we what? That we ask. Here go again. Above all that we ask. Prayer is so important, Lorraine said, yet it's not the first thing or the last thing we want to do. We have to remember we don't have to set up an altar to pray or run a repetitiously babbling nothingness. Yes, I agree with that. I agree with that. Let's see if I find where she is. These are the things that makes it hard. As we are transparent and consistent, we will enjoy being in God's presence. In fact, we will begin to run, we begin running to him. Well, you know, one of the things that I've recognized in prayer is that you know, if we always just go to God with a list, right? Always just a list. You know, prayer has to be more than that. And again, Jesus said, a friend said to a friend. In other words, God has to become more to you and I than just some big old gray-headed man sitting in heaven and waiting for as soon as you make a mistake to take a stick and hit you upside your head. God has to, your perception of God has to change. That's why Jesus come. And what did he say? The first thing he said to us, if you're going to learn how to pray, what did he say? What did he say? He said, our Father. Not our slave master, our Father. All of these things make considerably, they will help you considerably in your prayer if you understand these things. The Father said to his Son, all that I have is yours. You just didn't take advantage of it. See, prayer becomes delightful, especially when you begin to interact with God. You begin to understand, I don't just have to go in my prayer closet and pray. The Bible says pray without ceasing. I can learn how to be in step with God and always talking to him. My altar is my heart. And the more I know him, oh my God. Yes, Lord. One last thing. Look at this. I'm going to show you this. And if you were close to me, you'll probably throw your shoes at me. Okay? I'm going to show you this. Look at Genesis 18. Come on. Let's close here. James 1, verse 5 and 6 says the same thing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask. See there? Let him ask of God that gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to you. But let him ask what? In faith. nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. And then he continues and said, let not that man think he will receive anything of the Lord. How do I cure that? You cure unbelief by getting in the Word. Filling your heart with the Word. Look at this. The Lord just reminded me of this. Look at this. Genesis 18. Let's do this real quickly, okay? Because I know time is gone. Look at it real quickly. Let's say it. Verse 18. Seeing that Abraham, the Lord said, verse 17, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all nations of the earth shall be blessed by him. Because, notice what I said, for I know him. I know him. Did you see that? God said, I know him. He will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment. That's the same thing he told you. If we abide in him and his word abide in us. He said, I know him. Abraham, I know him by name. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. Glory. Verse 23. And Abraham drew near. Look at this. Abraham got close and said, will you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Now, I want you to see how Abraham is talking to God. I want you to see how he's talking. He's not talking like many of us will be, oh, please, Jesus, if you just might do that. He's not talking. Look how he's talking to God. Old Testament, look how he's talking to God. Peradventure, there be 50 righteous within the city. Will thou also destroy and not spare the place for the 50 righteous that are therein? Look how he's talking to God. He said, be far from you, Lord, to do this after this matter, to slay the righteous with the wicked, and that the righteous should be as the wicked. That be far from thee. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what's right? And the Lord answered, look at how he's talking to God. And the Lord said, If I find in Sodom 50 righteous within that city, then I will spare all the place for their sake. He fooled around and got God down to the point where he says, if there's 10 there, if he would have went all the way down to one, then God would have spared the city. God would have backed up. Listen to me. Now listen to this. Do you see how he's talking to God? That's what God is talking about. He's not talking, put it this way, he's talking to God as a son. How could Abraham talk that way? Because if you go back to chapter 15, and if you go to chapter 17, Abraham understood he had a covenant with God. He understood the place that he held with God. Do you understand this? Do you know this? Is this settled on the inside of you? And so Abraham didn't talk as a beggar. He talked as a man that had a right and a covenant with God. And you know what? God responded to Abraham because God understood also that Abraham had a covenant with him. It's the same thing here. Jesus said, though the guy would not rise simply because of his friendship, yet because of his importunity. In other words, the friend understood his place with his friend. He understood the relationship he had with his friend. And based on that, he understood that his friend, though he may not want to, will have to get up because he is not going to give in and just walk away. What gave him the boldness and the courage to do that is their relationship with one another. Are you following me? And what gives you and I the boldness to demand, that's not being rude. I'm talking about being bold. I'm talking about having courage. I'm talking about this display of courage and of boldness before God. that God delights in is because you know you have a relationship with God. And you know that you are asking what is in line with His Word. And folks, when you do that, God does not withhold it. You already know. All the promises of God are yea and amen. But what the devil does is he takes time in order to beat us and say, look how long it's been. It ain't going to happen. He uses all sorts of things, feelings, and all these things. I'm not saying they're not real. I'm a man just like you. I deal with it just like you. But you see, what you and I have to do is fill ourselves so much with the Word that it becomes so real. And you are so convinced of it that time and what the enemy does cannot detour you. And when the enemy throws up something at you, you take that stuff and you throw that lance and you stick him with it. Are you following me? There are six types of prayer that we're going to talk about. This is the second one that we're dealing with. Amen. Boy, I love you. Did that help you? Did that help any of you? I'm convinced, man. I am convinced. I am convinced. Though I am a man of flesh and bones, I am convinced that you and I are supposed to walk here with God. And what changes that, what makes it real to us, what will give us the boldness and the confidence, is not just going to church, it's filling yourself with the Word, making your home in it. See, make your home in it and make it your home. Fill yourself with it. And my, how that will change us. Amen. Boy, I love you. I love you in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Thank all of you. You are so wonderful. We appreciate you. Those of you who are with us, who are following with us, man, look. God bless you. I want to pray for you tonight. Father, I pray for my brother and my sister. Lord, I know there are challenges that we face, sickness, disease, things that come upon us, things that we have to fight. Lord God, but help us all to understand the power that's in your Word. And you and I taking the time to fill our lives with the Word, what it will do for us. Lord Jesus, I thank you for my brother and sister. Bless them. Minister your life, your healing to them tonight. Lift their burdens. In Jesus' name, I rebuke the powers of darkness against you and the powers of darkness that are coming against you. I dispel every work of the enemy. I bind the forces of darkness in Jesus' name. And I simply release God's Word and God's anointing to you, my brother and my sister. Be touched, be ministered to, be lifted, be encouraged, be blessed, be saved in the name of the Lord. If you need Jesus into your heart, just say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your blood. Come into my heart and save me. I receive it now. And Lord, while you're at it, fill me with the Holy Spirit and give me power to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Wow. This has been a wonderful time that we have spent together sharing the Word. I want to do something else, okay? Long after we are off the air, if something comes up where you say, you know what, I've had problems in prayer here, and I need some help, would you do me a favor? Would you just go to our website and send me an email, all right? Or you can go back and you can put it in the comment section, whatever you're comfortable in doing. If there's a particular thing in prayer that you say, you know what, I get that, but I'm having issues here, or I'm having challenges here. Would you address these things? Would you do that for me? Would you do that this week? Send me an email, or get in there and put it in the comment section. And look here, I will make that part of some things that we will address. If we get enough responses, then I will address these things, because I know there are people out there that have issues and challenges when it comes to this. And if you're not bashful and you're bold enough to declare it and say it, then I will be bold enough to deal with it and to take our next time that we're on the air and make sure that we address these things. Amen. Boy, thank you so much. I love you. Don't forget to go to YouTube, all right, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We love you in the Lord Jesus. God bless you. And remember, the power of the seed is not in its size, it's in its contents. God bless you, and have a pleasant evening. Bye-bye.